Welcome to Living Word Ministries with our director and Bible teacher, Debbie Blank. Debbie's passion is for you to understand and apply God's truths to your life. Now let's listen and enjoy teaching from the Word of God with Debbie Blank.
Oh, Father, you are the Holy One of Israel. It is you, Father, who called the Jewish people to yourself. You have loved them. You have nurtured them. You have cared for them. You have given them covenant promises. You've done everything for them down through the ages, and you will never leave them or forsake them. Father, as we study what tragedies are coming upon the Jewish people, it is not for your lack of love, it's for their lack of obedience that these tragedies come upon them. You don't change. You are perfect. But we change as people. And the Jewish people changed and turned away from you. Father, teach us tonight what we can learn about us, about you, and about situations of life when we turn away from you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I'm sure most of you remember in February of 2014 when Russia decided to go in to the Crimea in the Ukraine and take over that area. By the end of the year, they actually went in and took over northeastern Ukraine. And most of the world said, how can you do this? We believe it was because of oil, among other things, money, because that always seems to be at the back end of why we do some of the things we do. But they did this. And how did the Ukraine respond to this? They did nothing. Do you know why they did nothing? That's right. 20 years before, on December 5th, 1994, the United States signed an agreement with three countries, the Ukraine, Belarus, and Kazakhstan. It was called the Budapest Memorandum on Security Assurance. And what we said to those three countries is, if you will give up your nuclear weapons, then we will give you security, insurance against threats or the use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of your country. And I'm reading the quote from the particular memorandum. That's what we promised. So here, 20 years later, you have Russia who comes into the Ukraine and fight and takes away their territorial integrity and takes away their political independence in that part of their country. And what did we as the United States do?
Nothing.
Nothing. Even though we had a signed memorandum with them, a covenant agreement with these people, we did nothing to protect them. What does that say about our country and our leadership?
Weak.
Very weak. Very weak. What else?
Can't trust.
Who's got? Somebody. Yes? We don't follow our word. Our word is no good. Good. Somebody else?
I said we don't honor our agreements.
Okay, we don't honor our agreements. What kind of a person is that who doesn't honor their agreements?
Definitely not a person.
Yeah, not a Christian.
Right.
We can't trust them if they don't honor their agreements. So what does that tell the Ukraine and the rest of the country about our country? They can no longer trust us. When we make an agreement with them, it bears no water, at least under this current administration. I hope that changes under the next president. But that's certainly the way it is under this president. Well, that's what we're going to see here in chapter 17 tonight of Ezekiel. Yeah, the Russian brought in their navy, and we did nothing. By the way, the Russians and England are two of the other partners that signed the agreement in 1994. Russia completely ignored it, and we did nothing about it. What it says is our word is no good. You can't trust us when we break a covenant. Today, we're going to read about Israel, specifically Judah. Judah is the southern kingdom. Israel is the northern kingdom. It was taken into captivity in 722 BC. So we now have the southern kingdom, Judah. Judah doesn't keep its word. Its kings don't keep their word. And God doesn't like that. So let's begin by looking first at an overview, as we always do, because this is important to remember what the book's themes are about. God called Ezekiel, Ezekiel, by the way, was he originally a prophet? Does anybody remember what he originally was called to be? A priest. He was from the priestly family. He was to be a priest, but he couldn't be a priest because he's no longer in Israel. He was taken into captivity in 597 BC and taken to Babylon. So he goes to Babylon. God calls him as a prophet so he could speak the word of God to talk about Israel's coming destruction. And we see that in the first three chapters and then the next four chapters. In chapters 8 through 11, God wants him to talk of their destruction to let them understand their iniquity. When God convicts us of our iniquity or our sin, if we repent, what will God do? He will forgive. He will change his mind in certain directions. He will forestall judgments and other things. Looking at Jonah. Jonah was in the belly of the whale because he went away from God. That's how God got his attention. He finally came to his senses and he repented and God allowed him to live. If we will repent, God can change his mind. He never changes his character, but he can change his mind. So Ezekiel comes to tell them in chapters 8 through 11 of all their iniquity, of the things they've done in hopes that they will repent. Now we're in this section, chapters 12 to 19, where God is using Ezekiel to show signs and parables and riddles of the coming judgment. Don't you think the people would get a little tired of hearing about this? Wouldn't you think if you hear about this long enough, maybe you'd make some changes? Did Judah make some changes? They did not. That's right. They hardened their hearts and said, it's not going to happen to us. So that's what we've been seeing. These parables and signs were to a rebellious people who became fruitless, a fruitless vine, which led to a faithless wife. God used that example, which has led to broken covenants we're going to see tonight, which then leads to irresponsibility. Perhaps a better way of saying it is blame or putting the blame on other people for the problems that we have, which then leads to lack of leadership. We see this wonderful way that God explains to us everything that's going on just by this overview. Now, tonight, again, in chapter 17, we're going to talk about broken covenants. Then we're going to talk about lack of responsibility, irresponsibility, or personal responsibility, and then move into lack of leadership. So with that, let's look at Ezekiel 17, 1 and 2. Pretty simple. Now the word of the Lord came to me saying, son of man, profound a what? Riddle and speak a parable to the house of Israel. Now again, this says house of Israel. Israel's gone into exile. But now the only Jews that are left in the land is the house of Judah. So oftentimes God will interchange the word Israel and Judah to the people that are living there now. What's a riddle? A what? Okay, it's a question. Technically, it's an obscure idea, and it needs interpretation. So it's a question, but you can't really understand it until somebody interprets it. And then God says, too, that this is a parable. What's a parable? Story. That's right, an illustrated story. So we know that Ezekiel is going to give some kind of a riddle along with the story that goes along with it. So we begin understanding this riddle in verse 3. The riddle says, and the parable says, thus says the Lord God, a great eagle with great wings, long pinions, and a full plumage of many colors came to Lebanon and took away the top of the cedar. Let's read verse 4 too, and then we will explain it. It says, he plucked off the topmost of its young twigs and brought it to a land of merchants. He set it in a city of traders. Now, do any of you have any idea what that means? Probably not, because it's a riddle. We need it explained to us. So before we do, though, there are a few things that we can understand. In the Bible, can you remember any time where a nation has been referred to as an eagle? Besides with the United States, we consider ourselves the eagle because that's our national bird, but we're not in the Bible. So where? Rome in the Bible?
Babylon.
Yeah.
Babylon.
In Daniel chapter 7, I think it's verse 4, Babylon is referred to as an eagle. When we see this talking about eagle, we're talking about a nation, and specifically the nation of Babylon. We know historically it's Babylon that is coming up against Judah at this time. We are in 592 BC. Jerusalem and the temple will be destroyed in 586 BC by what nation? Babylon. So we're talking here about Babylon. When God says in verse 3, a great eagle, he's talking about Babylon, the nation of Babylon. In order to understand this, rather than having us walk through the whole thing and wait for the understanding, I'm going to take you right to the understanding. We have verses 3 and 4, and then if we jump over to verses 11 and 12 in this same chapter, God explains to us the answer to this riddle. Because after all, somebody has to. We can't understand it. So if you turn to verses 11 and 12, and those of you who get this in advance probably read it, as Sam did, and wondered if I messed up because my verses were not in order. But I didn't. This is the answer to tell us what those first few verses mean. God says, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, say now to the rebellious house." Who's the rebellious house? Israel. "Do you not know what these things mean? Say, behold, the king of Babylon came to Jerusalem, took its kings and princes, and brought them to him in Babylon." So that's what we're talking about here in these first few verses. I'm not going to explain the kings yet. We'll wait until we've read all this to explain it. What happens is Babylon has come. They've come, it says, to Lebanon, but Lebanon is an example of that area of Israel and Lebanon. So he came to Lebanon and he took away the top of the cedar. If you recall from what we've talked about in this class, in 605 BC, Nebuchadnezzar first came to the first conquest. And who did he take back with him to Babylon? Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, some of the premium people, the princes of Israel, he took back with him. That could be the top of the cedar that he's talking about. It doesn't really clarify it. In verse 4, it says he plucked off the topmost of its young twigs. That could be the kings that we're going to see here very soon. What we do know is the eagle's talking about Babylon and them carrying off people to their land. Now let's go back to verse 5 on this riddle. Verses 5 and 6 say, "He also took some of the seed of the land and planted it in fertile soil. He placed it beside abundant waters. He set it like a willow. Then it sprouted and became a low-spreading vine with its branches turned toward him. But its roots remained under it. So it became a vine and yielded shoots and sent out branches." Okay, again, a little hard to understand. When we see a vine mentioned in Scripture, generally, who is that referring to? Israel.
Oh,
Israel.
Vine and the branch.
The vine and the branches. Generally, in the Old Testament specifically, the vine is talking about Israel. So here we know that the king of Babylon, well, let's interpret this from verses 13 and 14, and then we'll explain a little bit more. In verses 13 and 14, you have a picture here of leaders bowing down to a king. Because in this passage it says, "He," meaning the king of Babylon, "took one of the royal family and made a covenant with him, putting him under oath. He also took away the mighty of the land, that the kingdom might be in subjection, not exalting itself, but keeping his covenant that it might continue." So we understand a little bit more now. You don't have the exact people's names yet. We'll get to that. But you understand that the king of Babylon made a covenant with the king of Israel at that time. And the king of Israel, it says in verse 14, the king of Israel would be in what to the kingdom of Babylon? In subjection to them. So that Israel would no longer be independent, it would be under the control of the Babylonians. All right, this is the riddle that Ezekiel's profounding to the people of Israel to let them know that they're going to be taken over, that people are going to be exiled out, and that kings are going to be in subjection to Babylon. Let's go back to verse 7 now, because we have the third part of the riddle. It says, but there was another eagle, another great eagle. So what does that tell you if there's another great eagle? Another country. All right, there's another great eagle, another country with great wings and much plumage. Very much a powerful country because it's described as Babylon is. And behold, this vine, Israel, bent its roots toward him and sent out its branches towards him from the beds where it was planted that he might water it. It was planted in good soil besides abundant waters that it might yield branches and bear fruit and become a splendid vine. So now, well, I don't want to explain this. Let's go over to verse 15 to explain it. In verse 15 it says, but the king who had made a covenant with Babylon in verse 13 and 14 rebelled against that king of Babylon by sending his envoys to Egypt that he might give him horses and many troops. So he made a covenant with, the king made a covenant with Babylon. And then he broke that covenant, and he instead decided he was going to go to Egypt and get help from Egypt with many troops, it says, many horses and many troops. He was going to get warriors from Egypt to fight against the king of Babylon, even though he had a covenant with the king of Babylon. Verse 15, will he succeed? Will he who does such thing escape? Can he indeed break the covenant and escape? No, he cannot. So now let's look at the kings. You have a list here of the kings that are in power at the time that this is being talked about, or at least around the time. First, I'm going to start over here on the right, even though I shouldn't start over there. But Babylon is not going to come into power until 609 BC. Power to the point that it can control Israel. And when it does, it's by Nebuchadnezzar's father, Nabopolassar. Nebuchadnezzar doesn't become king until 605 BC. We look at Egypt. There's a couple of powerful kings. Oh, we're missing somebody down here. One of the things didn't show up. We're missing, we see Necho. Pharaoh Necho is a powerful king, long about 609 BC. He's actually king from 609 until 594 BC. Now, what you don't see down here, because it's off the charts, but way down here, there's another pharaoh from Egypt called Hophni, Hophra. And he is the one who's in power in 586 when Jerusalem is destroyed. So there's a couple of powerful pharaohs from Egypt. And then you have the powerful kings from Babylon. And guess what country is in the middle of both of them? Israel. If you look at a map, you've got Egypt down here and you've got Babylon over here. And in order for them to get to each other or fight each other, Egypt and Babylon, they have to go right through Israel. So Israel is this prime land that both countries want. I'm going to give you a little history lesson here. Josiah was a good king. He was the last good king in Israel. Many of you may know the story of him, or in Judah, in the southern kingdom. May know the story. He became king at what age? I think it's 7, but for some reason I'm thinking 8. So I want to go to 2 Kings and double check that. 8 years old. Yeah, 2 Kings chapter 22, verse 1. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. He did great things in Israel, made great reforms like they hadn't seen in a long time. So he was a good king, but he made a really stupid decision. When Pharaoh Necho was going up to fight the Assyrians who were conversing with the Babylonians, and he was fighting for power with them, Josiah decided he was going to get in the mix of this and go out and fight the Pharaoh at Megiddo. And he died. The Pharaoh even told him, don't fight me. But he did anyway, and Josiah died at that point. So you see Pharaoh Necho listed as 609 because that's when Josiah died. Then his son, Josiah's son, Joahaz, became king of Judah because Pharaoh Necho appointed him as such. But he was only king for 3 months and then was imprisoned in Egypt. So that was a short-lived kingship. None of what we've been reading today involves either of those kings. What we see begins with Jehoiakim. Now, you got to be careful because you have Jehoiakim in 609, and in 597, you have Jehoiachin. They look very much the same, but they're different kings. So when you go back to Ezekiel 17, verse 4, that's talking about the king of Babylon taking away the tops of the trees that we find out are kings and leaders, that's Jehoiakim. What happened is, it was Nebuchadnezzar that ended up coming in a little bit later, but Nabopolassar first came in and, Jehoiakim first became the puppet leader for Egypt. Egypt made him king. Now, I say that, if you know history, this is the southern kingdom. Every king in the southern kingdom must follow what lineage? The lineage of David. Because the Messiah will come from the lineage of David, which comes from the southern kingdom. So all of these kings are related. Fortunately, the Egyptian king chose to make Josiah's son, his oldest son, the king in his place to keep that lineage going. So unfortunately for Jehoiakim, he was taken, became a puppet king. So he ended up giving lots of gold and silver to Egypt in order to be under their a vassal under them. Well, then comes the Battle of Carchemish. That was the huge battle where Babylon now became a world force. They defeated Assyria, and they were also fighting Egypt at the Battle of Carchemish. Carchemish is, if you're familiar with Turkey, modern Turkey today, and what we used to call Asia Minor, and then it curves down where Israel is over here. Carchemish is like right in this area up here, just north of Israel. Huge battle there, and that's when Babylon came out victorious and became the world leader in 605 BC. Well, at that point, they came down to Jerusalem and decided, the king of Babylon decided that he was going to make Jehoiakim his puppet king. No longer Egypt's, because they're destroyed. But that meant that he was a vassal of the king of Babylon. He had to give him, if you read it in 2 Kings, he gave him a lot of the articles from the temple, and he sent away a lot of the leaders from Israel to Babylon. That happened in 605 BC. And it's Jehoiakim, it's not Jehoiakim that we're talking about here, it's Jehoiachin. Then we have the second exile in 597. Then enters Jehoiachin. That's who we're seeing here. One of the kings we're seeing here in Daniel, in Ezekiel 17, is Jehoiachin. And Jehoiachin was taken into exile into Babylon, so he wasn't there very long. Interesting story, if you want to read the end of 2 Kings 22. Jehoiachin was taken into exile in Babylon in 597 and put in prison. In 561, 36 years later, evil King Merodach from Babylon, for some reason, decided he liked Jehoiachin, brought him out of prison, and sat him at the king's table for the rest of his life. Nobody can understand why. We don't know, but that happened. Well, when King Nebuchadnezzar took Jehoiachin, he put in Zedekiah. Again, all of the same family lineage. He put him in as king in Jerusalem to be his vassal king there. Here's where you have a problem. And the problem is here with Zedekiah. He's the one that made a covenant with Babylon to follow them in 597 BC, but then he turned away from Babylon. And he went again to Hophni, Pharaoh of Egypt, to try and get his allegiance against Babylon. That's when he broke the covenant. You see, a lot of history there, but if you go back to verse 15 that we looked at, it said he, Zedekiah, rebelled against the king of Babylon by sending his envoys to Egypt, to Pharaoh Hophni, to help him fight Babylon. In other words, Zedekiah was a liar. Fascinating to me, because it's not like Zedekiah is king of Israel because of his heritage. He's king of Israel because the king of Babylon put him in that position. But he got arrogant along the way and got to thinking, oh gosh, Babylon's way far away. They're not going to come up and bother us anymore. We're just going to do what we want, and we want to keep our independence. So we're not going to give any money to Babylon anymore. They were raising taxes to pay Babylon. And he just decided he wasn't going to do it anymore. That caused the destruction of Jerusalem, the destruction of the temple. Ezekiel is telling what is going to happen. Some things that have happened, but also what is going to happen as they move forward. All right, this, if you enjoy history, you'll want to go to 2 Kings, at least starting in chapter 22 and reading about Josiah into the end of 24 or 25, because it's really a fascinating story to see what happened. That's what Ezekiel's talking about here, is that history. Now, let's go back to some verses we haven't read in Ezekiel 17. After Ezekiel lays out the riddle in the first 8 verses, and then he's going to start answering them in verse 11. But here, we see in verses 9 and 10, say, thus says the Lord, will it thrive? Will what thrive? Who have we been talking about? Israel, the country of Israel, the vine. Will the vine thrive? Will he not pull up its roots and cut off its fruit so that it withers, so that all its sprouting leaves wither? And neither by great strength nor by many people can it be raised from its roots again. Well, this is interesting, because he says the same thing in verse 10. Behold, though it is planted, Israel is, will it thrive? Will it not completely wither as soon as the east wind strikes it? That's Babylon. Wither on the beds where it grew. Well, let's think about that for a minute. Israel is trying to fight Babylon for control of their land. What's wrong with that? Why is God going to say that they're going to wither because they're trying to defend their land against Babylon? What, John?
God promised.
Okay, first of all, they had a covenant with Babylon that they had made, and now they're breaking their covenant. Very good. At no point at all are they calling on God. They're depending on men to take care of their earthly situation instead of depending on God. Do we do that? We do. We oftentimes use all of our resources to do everything we can to take care of every situation. And then when we can't do anything else, then we go to God. And we ask God to take care of it. Now, there's wisdom. I mean, if you're going to have surgery, you go when you get a couple of opinions and you do all the research and you learn that. There's wisdom involved in decisions that you make. But we have to be careful and remember that it's God's always got to be in those decisions. Everything that we do, and Israel had turned away from God, completely taken him out of this. And God has said, I'm sending Babylon to destroy you. He has said that, and they're not listening. They're still doing what they want to do instead of seeking what God wants with Babylon. So God's saying, you're not going to thrive. Not going to happen. This isn't going to work, folks. You may go down to Egypt, but it's not going to work. We're going to see more of that as we turn to now verses 16 and 17, when he answers that. He says, as I live, declares the Lord God, surely in the country of the king who put him on the throne, whose oath he despised and whose covenant he broke, in Babylon he shall die. So God's talking here about Zedekiah. Zedekiah, the king of Babylon, put him on the throne. He made an oath to the king of Babylon, but he despised it because he broke it. And now he's told that he's going to die in Babylon. Do you know how he died? In chapter 24 of 2 Kings, It says that when Nebuchadnezzar came up against the land, verse 6, chapter 25, 2 Kings 25, 6, they captured the king, Zedekiah, and brought him to the king of Babylon at Riblah, and he passed sentence on him there. And his sentence was, he slaughtered the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes. Tough thing. Then he put out the eyes of Zedekiah, bound him with bronze fetters, and brought him to Babylon. And that's where he ended up dying. That was his consequence because he didn't listen to God, he didn't seek God, and then he broke the covenant with Babylon. God says there's a consequence for breaking your covenants. Do you just wake up one day and decide to break a covenant? When we make our decisions, they're usually based on our lifestyle. By that I mean, if we're walking with Jesus Christ in everything that we do, if we're seeking his wisdom and his guidance, then we should be walking in a manner worthy of him. We should be living a godly life. And when we are, and difficult times come, we seek God for his wisdom and we follow him. When that happens, we don't break covenants. We don't make decisions lightly when we're following the Lord. But when we're not following the Lord, what do?
Make a lot of mistakes.
We make a lot of mistakes. We do what seems right in our own eyes. And that's what we're seeing here. He wasn't following God, so when tough times came, he just did what he thought he should do. Well, when tough times come on you, if you're not following God, what you will probably do, what we do in life, is we go to friends and we ask for their advice. And then we make our decision based on pros and cons of what we've gotten from friends. Advice is good. Counsel is good. But there's better counsel. Counsel from the one who knows what the future holds. Counsel from the one who has you in the palm of his hand, who has a perfect plan for you. Wouldn't you rather go to him rather than going to friends who are just giving you their advice based on their life experiences? There's a lot to learn here. Zedekiah made some really bad mistakes. He found himself in a position of power. Reminds us a lot of our country as we get back to the idea of breaking covenants. Found himself in a position of power, thought that he was the greatest there was, and that nobody could conquer him. And he had God's favor because he was a Christian nation, actually a Jewish nation, but for us, we think we're a Christian nation and God's not going to do anything to it. Is that true? No, it's not. When we break covenants, when we turn away from God, we have consequences. And you talk about breaking a covenant. What's the biggest covenant we can break? The worst covenant we can break?
We've already broken it here in America.
Okay, she said we've already broken it here in America.
No, I mean, we were going to stay with God, and God would have top priority. He doesn't anymore.
Just turning away from God. We have broken our covenant with God here in this country. We haven't just broken it with Ukraine and other countries. We've broken it with God. There's consequences to that, folks. Consequences. And the consequence here is that Zedekiah was going to die. Verse 17, Pharaoh with his mighty army and great company will not help him in war when they cast up ramps and build siege walls to cut off many lives. Egypt's not going to protect you. Your friends aren't going to protect you. The world isn't going to protect you. Your government isn't going to protect you, folks. Only God can protect you. But you have to turn to him. Don't just wait for time of need. Find the joy of living your life abundantly with Christ every day. Because then you have him right there to give you answers, to lead you and guide you in the way that you should go. Unfortunately, Zedekiah didn't follow him. Verses 18 to 21, we conclude or come near the conclusion here of this riddle. It says, now he despised the oath by breaking the covenant. We're still talking about Zedekiah. And behold, he pledged his allegiance, yet did all these things. He shall not escape. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, as I live, surely my oath which he despised and my covenant which he broke, I will inflict on his head. Now, wait a minute. I thought Zedekiah broke the covenant with Nebuchadnezzar. Who's he breaking the covenant with here? God. He's broken the covenant with God. There's a consequence to that, too. Verse 20. I will spread my net over him, and he will be caught in my snare. Then I will bring him to Babylon, we just read about that, and enter into judgment with him there regarding the unfaithful act which he has committed against me. All the choice men and all his troops will fall by the sword, and the survivors will be scattered to every wind. We know that is going to happen in 586 B.C. It hasn't happened yet from when Ezekiel is writing this, but Ezekiel is prophesying that it's going to happen. Why? And then what does God say at the end of verse 21? Okay, it's a little different than what we're used to. Usually he says, you will know that I am the Lord. Here he says, you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken. Sometimes we wait until we see what God says in his word come to life before we really realize it's God. Oh, if we have that daily walk with him, not just Sunday morning for an hour, but that daily walk with God, then we can see him day by day. We know him. We recognize him. Now, I say that in general. We all have dry periods of time where it's like God is silent to us. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, generally speaking, day by day, walking with God so that we hear him and we obey him. If Zedekiah had done that, do you think God would have allowed this curse to come upon him? Would he have been killed? Would he have seen his kids killed? Would he have had his eyes gouged out and taken to Babylon? I don't think so. I think God would have relented. Now, it's not to say that problems wouldn't still happen to Israel, but I don't think it would have happened to Zedekiah. Because every time somebody in the Bible repents, God relents. Yeah, that's a good point. You have two leaders in Israel. You have the high priest, who's the religious leader, and then you have the king, who's the physical leader. So you have both of them turned away from God. But Zedekiah, it says in 2 Kings 24, verse 18, he was 21 years old when he became king, and he reigned 11 years. Verse 19, he did evil in the sight of the Lord according to all that Jehoiakim had done, so all that his predecessor had done. For through the anger of the Lord, this came about in Jerusalem and Judah until he cast them out from his presence. And Zedekiah rebelled against the king of Babylon. So we see two rebellions there. One is doing evil in the sight of the Lord, and the other is rebelling against the king of Babylon. Exactly what Ezekiel's talking about here. Well, now we're going to enter in a different thought, because God is so gracious to us. When he talks about condemnation, he always gives us hope. And in this hope, in verse 22, it says, thus says the Lord God, I will also take a sprig from the lofty top of the cedar and set it out. I will pluck from the topmost of its young twigs a tender one, and I will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. In this chapter, when he's talking about twigs and the top of the cedar, who's he been talking about? Kings. All right, so he's saying, I'm going to bring a king, and I'm going to plant him on the high and lofty mountain. What king do you think this is going to be? Jesus. Let's look at verses 23 and 24. He says, on the high mountain of Israel, I will plant it, that it might bring forth boughs and bear fruit and become a steady, stately cedar. And birds of every kind will nest under it. They will nest in the shade of its branches. All the trees of the field will what? Know that I am the Lord. And remember, I mean, trees and birds are used to represent nations. Birds represent nations and people, and trees representing nations. He says, I will bring down the high tree, exalt the low tree, dry up the green tree, and make the dry tree flourish. Why? Because I am the Lord, I have spoken, and I will perform it. Now, how do we know this is talking about Jesus? I mean, does it say Jesus? Does it even say the Messiah? Does it say the King? The only way we can know this is Jesus is by cross-referencing. So let's go to a couple places in Scripture. Let's start with Isaiah chapter 11. Verses 1 and 2 is what we'll read here. Because remember, Jesus, the person here is being referred to as a twig, a tender one, up on the mountains, being planted, bearing fruit. Isaiah 11, 1 and 2 says, then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse. Who's Jesse? The father of David. All right, so this is going to come. David is where the Messiah is going to come from his lineage. So Jesse's his dad. The shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. Well, that's what we're talking about here, is a branch, a bough, bearing fruit and becoming a stately cedar. Let's turn to Jeremiah 23, because it says some very similar things in verse 5. I think that's the right place. Yes. Jeremiah 23, 5. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I shall raise up for David a righteous branch. That's one of the names known for Jesus. And he will reign as king and act wisely and do justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will dwell securely. And this is his name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness. Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. Talking here a prophecy of the Messiah. Very similar to what we're seeing here. Very similar words. Then there's one other verse I'll take you to, and that's Luke. In Luke chapter 1, we see a very similar description to what we see in verse 24. And that's Luke 1:52. What it says is, get it here. He has brought down rulers from their thrones and has exalted those who were humbled. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent away the rich empty-handed. The key here is that verse 52 is brought down rulers from the thrones and exalted those who are humble, just like verse 24 says. He will bring down the high tree, the rulers, and he will exalt the low. He will dry up the green tree and make dry tree flourish. So we see three different places in Scripture that sound very similar to this that's talking about Jesus as the Messiah. In the middle of all the ways that these kings have and will, from the time Ezekiel's writing this, turn away from God, disobey God, and negate covenants, God still gives them hope. So what does that tell us for our country today? Is there hope? Is the hope in the next president? No king will save us. No president will save us. No governor will save us. Only God will save us. Well, when we talk about blaming, that's something that we're seeing. Our leaders blame everybody. Oh, it's their fault. President Obama, when he came in, everything was George W. Bush's fault. It's interesting because 7 years later, everything is still George W. Bush's fault. Because where did blame come onto the scene? When did we first see it in life? Adam and Eve. Adam said, this woman who you gave me caused me to do it. And she said, this serpent caused me to do it. So, I mean, Adam even blamed God because God gave him Eve who tempted him. So blaming is something that we've done all throughout the generations. And now we're going to see it here in chapter 18 in Ezekiel, where they blame one another for the problems that they're having. Individual responsibility is what this chapter is about. If you have children in your lives who are not walking with the Lord, this is a great chapter that you need to pay attention to. Even though this is talking about Israel and individual responsibility, it's great. There's great peace in here about us as parents. We start in verses 1 through 3 saying, then the word of the Lord came to me saying, what do you mean by using this proverb concerning the land of Israel? And what's the proverb? You see it up here? The father eats the sour grapes, but the children's teeth are set on edge. And then God says, as I live, declares the Lord God, you are surely not going to use this proverb in Israel anymore. Are you? And the answer should be no. That's the idea here. This proverb was also used in the book of Jeremiah. Same thing. in Jeremiah 31, verses 29 and 30. As a matter of fact, I want to read that to you because it adds a little bit to it than what we see here. In Jeremiah 31, interesting because this is the passage of the covenant passage that's promised to the Jews. Jeremiah 31, 29, in those days they will not say again, the fathers have eaten sour grapes and the children's teeth are set on edge. But everyone will die for his own iniquity. Each man who eats the sour grapes, his teeth will be set on edge. So that verse explains what the proverb means. And what does it say? What does the proverb mean? Based on that interpretation. Yeah, we have personal responsibility. It says everyone will die for his own sin. We can't blame somebody else for our problems today. I mean, if we look at us today in our country, we say, well, gosh, we got all these problems with the unions taking all of our money because of our forefathers who set the unions up getting these huge pensions. We're blaming what happened. It happened. It's done. It's out there. Let's make some changes if necessary. But what good does it do to blame? We're blaming. We're saying, well, we're suffering the consequences. Our children are going to suffer the consequences of a $19 trillion debt. Yep. You know, we're blaming our leaders for not having it happen. It's easy to blame, but let's be part of the solution instead of the criticism. Here it says, again, back in Jeremiah, explaining this, everybody's going to die for his own iniquity. Each one's responsible for his own sour grapes. It's his teeth that'll be set on edge. What he's saying really here, the people are saying, well, we're suffering as children because of the sins of the father. That's what they're saying in this proverb. And what God is saying is everybody has personal responsibility. Now, the fact of the matter is, Israel is going into exile. Israel is going to be destroyed because of the sins of Manasseh. I mean, God said, I'm going to destroy Israel because of your sins. So it is the sins of the father. But could the sons have stopped it? Israel could have stopped this at any time, changed it, because God would have forgiven them if they had simply confessed, repented before God, but they didn't. So now instead of taking personal responsibility for their sins, they're blaming their parents. I found familiar today. My gosh, counselors are getting rich. Well, no counselor gets rich. But we have so many counselors now because everybody's going and saying, well, I'm really messed up and my parents did this to me. I mean, we're blaming our parents instead of taking personal responsibility. We're blaming our government. We're blaming our churches. We're blaming our bosses. We got to stop blaming and take personal responsibility. That's what this chapter is about. So we're going to look at verse 4 and then move on to understand this. But verse 4 says, behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father, as well as the soul of the Son, is mine. The soul who sins will die. God is the ultimate judge. He will judge the souls of people individually, not according to somebody else. When someone gets to the afterlife and they stand before Jesus, because Philippians 2 says, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So everyone will eventually stand before Christ. If they're going to the lake of fire for eternity, they don't get a second chance, but they will stand before Christ. So let's say somebody stands up and says, well, I didn't do it because my husband told me that I was supposed to do this instead. Or my boss told me that I had to sign off on these illegal papers or I was going to lose my job. We're losing the personal responsibility. We are accountable directly to God. Yes, we are under the authority of our husbands, submissiveness, under our bosses, under our governments. We are, and there's, you know, that's another whole story of explanation. But we have personal responsibility when it comes to Jesus Christ and everything we do. And I want you to know, I don't want to stand in front of Jesus and try and blame anybody for what I did. It's not going to work. Jesus could say, stop, wait, whoa. Now he's not going to do this, but I kind of think of him as doing the same stuff. Debbie, let's just talk about you. Nobody else. Just you. That's a very good point, because he said the Jews believe in a corporate salvation. If you were raised Catholic, you have that same mentality. which is, as a Catholic, if you are baptized as a Catholic, and if you do not have mortal sin in your life, you have a corporate salvation. You are saved. That is the only way you're saved. I mean, you cannot be saved if you're a Protestant and are baptized. You've got to be a Catholic and baptized. So different religions have corporate mentalities when it comes to salvation. And Jesus here is talking about individual responsibility, not religious or corporate. Obviously, the Catholics came along a lot longer after that, but not the Jews. The Jews were involved. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about three different people. We're going to talk about a father, a son, and a grandson, three different generations. And because I read well in bullet points, I put these in bullet points for you because really from chapter 18, verses 5 to 9, God just laid out a whole bunch of great bullet points of how righteous this father was. And what he says about him, this man is righteous and he practices justice and righteousness. He doesn't eat at the mountain shrines. That's the temples of Baal. He doesn't lift up his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel or defile his neighbor's wife. Obviously, that wouldn't be good. Or approach a woman during her menstrual period. If a man does not oppress anyone, but restores to the debtor his debt, does not commit robbery, gives bread to the hungry, covers the naked with clothing, if he does not lend money or interest or take increase, if he keeps his hand from iniquity and executes true justice between man and man, if he walks in my statutes and my ordinance so as to deal faithfully. Now, this sounds like a pretty good guy, doesn't it? I mean, it sounds as good as it comes. And God says, if he does all those things, he is righteous and he will live. Now, I encourage you, pray those things for yourself. Pray these and ask God to help you be a man or a woman of righteousness who practices justice and righteousness. God says that a person who does these things is righteous and will surely live. Now understand, it doesn't say he's saved, even though righteousness is synonymous with saved a lot in Scripture. But the very last point, he walks in my statutes and my ordinances so as to deal faithfully, tells me this is a person of God who wants a relationship with God. I encourage you. Take Scripture, pray Scripture. Best thing to do is pray Scripture back to God because it's his words back to him. And if you want to be a righteous person, these are great adjectives to have God build in your life. So this is the first generation, the righteous father, so to speak. Now we go to his son, starting the second generation in verses 10 to 13. And we see the same bullet points here because we see the negatives of the son. He's a violent son. He sheds blood. Who does any of these things to a brother. In the third bullet point, he eats at the mountain shrines and defiles his neighbor's wife. He oppresses the poor and needy, commits robbery, does not restore a pledge, lifts up his eyes to the idols and commits abominations. He lends money on interest and takes increase. Not supposed to do that within the Jewish community. Will he live? He will not live, God says. Do you notice that these are just the exact opposite of his father? I mean, the words, the phrases, the adjectives, the explanations are the exact opposite of what his father did. What's going to happen to him? He has committed all these abominations. He will surely be put to death. His blood will be on his own head. Now, those of you who have lived a godly life and you have a child who isn't, I hope that this is a chapter of encouragement for you to know that even though you do everything you can possibly do to be a godly parent and to draw your kids to the Lord, they have an individual responsibility and they have a free will to make up their own minds. Continue to pray for them. Continue to be there for them. Reach out to them. Let them know that you love them unconditionally. Don't tolerate their bad behavior, but love them unconditionally because you never know what God will do to convict them of their sins. But walk away from here tonight encouraged that God says you've got one generation that's walking with him and the next generation isn't necessarily. It's not your fault. Don't blame yourself. You did the best you could at the time you could. Confess it, move on, and pray for your kids. Now let's move to the third generation. Now behold, he has a son. This is the son of the violent man who has observed all his father's sins which he committed. And observing, he doesn't want to do them. So it says, he doesn't eat at the mountain shrines or lift up his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel or defile his neighbor's wife or oppress anyone or retain a pledge or commit robbery. But he gives his bread to the hungry, covers the naked with clothing. He keeps his hand from the poor, does not take interest by increase, but executes my ordinances and walks in my statutes. Who does this sound like? Grandpa. You know, it sounds like the first generation, almost exactly like the first generation. So what do you think is going to happen to this grandson, this third generation? He will not die for his father's iniquity. He will surely live. As for his father, because he pressed extortion and robbed his brother and did what was not good among his people, behold, he will die for his iniquity, but not the son. Are you familiar with the passage in Exodus chapter 20? I think it's verse 5 in the Ten Commandments. It says, I will rain the iniquity of the fathers down on the children to the third and fourth generation. How do you balance that from Exodus with what we've just seen here?
Still have free will.
I'm not catching your last
free
word.
Will.
Free will. We still have a free will. That's important to remember. You see, I see that passage from Ezekiel saying that if my family has a propensity towards alcoholism, then I'm going to have that propensity. That doesn't mean I'll do it, but it means I may be tempted to do it. If I have a friend whose mother is a wonderful Christian gal, but she's scared, she's afraid all the time, she's anxious all the time. So she's always worrying and she's always negative. I can't do this, we can't do that, something might happen. She's that way. And guess what's happening to the daughter? She's anxious all the time and she's fearful and she's afraid to try things and do that. That's what I see as the sins of the father. We have generational sins that are in our lives that come from our parents, but we can stop them because we have free will. We have the ability to go to God and say, God, I recognize this and we need to stop it. He said that the slide before, the second guy rejected him, excuse me, the second generation rejected the father, but the third generation chose to reject the bad generation. He chose to stop the sins of the father. So we can stop them if we recognize them. We don't want to turn around and blame. We all have strengths and weaknesses that come from our heritage. But we can stop those. We can make those decisions. So God is talking here about personal responsibility. Let's go on to read verse 19 and 20, where it says, Yet you say, why should the son not bear the punishment for the father's iniquity? When the son has practiced justice and righteousness and observed all my statutes and done them, he shall surely live. Makes sense. The person who sins shall surely die. And obviously we're all going to die physically. So what's he talking about here when he says they're all going to die? Okay, he's talking about eternal life. He's talking about the second death. The second death that will put us in hell for all eternity because we haven't followed God. The person who sins will die. The son will not bear the punishment for his father's iniquity, nor will the father bear the punishment for his son's iniquity. The righteousness of the righteous will be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked will be upon him. Stop blaming. Take personal responsibility. Now he's going to give a couple of examples here, starting in verse 21. He says, but if the wicked man turns from his sins. So now we're getting another scenario. We got the second generation who's wicked. If this generation, this man, turns from his sins, which he has committed, and observes all my statutes and practices justice and righteousness, he shall surely, what? Live and not die. All his transgressions, which he has committed, will not be remembered against him because of his righteousness, which he has practiced. He will live. What does that tell you about God? He's forgiving, and he's changing his whole scenario. What he just said was the consequence for the man turning against God. Now he's changing it. He's saying if they repent, if the wicked man repents, I will forgive him. He will live. So think about that in relation to what's happening in Israel at this time. If they'll repent, if they stop being violent men, if they will be righteous men, Do you think God would allow them to live? I think so. We never got to see that. But I think that's the point God's making here. But then there's the other side of the coin. It says in verse 24, but when a righteous man turns away from his righteousness, commits iniquity, and does according to all the abominations that a wicked man does, will he live? Now, we're not talking here about eternal security, so don't get confused on this. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking here about how a person is living and how God calls them to live. Because once we are saved, we can never lose that salvation. Ephesians 1:13 says that when we believe in Jesus Christ, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. I want to read you that exactly because the sealing part is exactly, but the first part of it isn't. And I want you to hear this. Very important. It says, Ephesians 1:13, in him, Jesus Christ, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having believed, you were sealed with him with the Holy Spirit of promise. So first you heard the gospel, then you believed in the gospel message of Jesus Christ, then you are sealed. And when God seals something, nobody can break it. So this is not talking about eternal security. Don't confuse that. He's making a point here that when people turn away, there's consequences. Getting back to verse 24. All his righteous deeds which he has done will not be remembered for his treachery which he has committed and for his sin which he's committed. For them he will die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord, that's not right. Well, that doesn't make sense. It's just not fair. That's what they're saying. Putting a little emphasis here, but that's what they're saying. It's not fair. Hear now, O house of Israel. Is my way not right? Is not your ways that are not right? When a righteous man turns away from his righteousness and commits iniquity and dies because of it, for his iniquity which he has committed, he will die. But don't tell God he's not fair. God has laid out who he is and what his plans are and what it takes to know him and walk with him. It's up to us to have personal responsibility to do it. And if we follow him, we will live. And if we don't follow him, we will die. It's black and white, folks. It's as simple as that. There's no middle ground. You can't choose a middle ground. So if the bad guy, the violent man, repents, God's going to forgive him. If the righteous man turns away from God, God's not going to forgive that. So when you think that you can just, as a Christian, you can do whatever you want, not worry about it, well, you're going to go to heaven because God promises that. But you're not going to have a life on earth that honors God or that is a joyful one because you're not walking with him here. You've chosen your own way, not God's. Now we go back. We've got the same picture here because we go back to the positive. He says, again, when a wicked man turns from his wickedness, which he has committed and practices justice and righteousness, he will save his life. Because he considered and turned away from all his transgressions which he has committed, he shall surely live, he shall not die. Let me stop here for a minute. Maybe that will explain this a little bit better. In the Bible, if you're familiar with judgment, the judgment of the righteous and the judgment seat of Christ, judgment of the righteous is 2 Corinthians 5:10. Those are for believers. The judgment of the condemned is the judgment seat of Christ, which is in Revelation 20, verses 11 to 15. What you read in those judgments is the books are opened, and another book is opened. We learn in the Bible that there's really three different basic books. One is, at judgment, the books of the deeds that you have done. Okay, those books are open, and God sees the deeds that you have done. But then you have two books of life. There's the Lamb's book of life, that if your name is written in the Lamb's book of life, you are saved. You are going to eternity with Jesus Christ. It's several places in the book of Revelation and elsewhere. In the book of Revelation chapter 20, when the Lamb's book of life is open, if their names are not written in it, they do not go to heaven. That's the name where you are written in there if you have believed in Jesus Christ. Then, as I mentioned, you have those other books of the books of deeds that you're going to be judged on. But the Bible talks about another book of life. And that book of life is called the Book of the Living. It's a book that's referred to in the Old Testament, specifically Exodus, that's a book of life for everybody who's alive at that time. And then when they die, their name is erased from that book. Don't get that confused with the Lamb's Book of Life, for which you cannot be erased from. So when we're talking here about dying, I said earlier, spiritual death, I'm thinking really that maybe this is physical death, that they would die for their sins, that God would judge them and they would die for their sins. The physical death, their names would be taken out of the Book of the Living, because we know they can never be taken out of the Book of Life, the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, I don't have the chapters and verses up. I mean, that's a 45-minute to an hour discussion if we discussed all those three books, but do your own research, because it's fascinating. So when God says here, dying, I do believe he's probably talking about physical, not spiritual, which I had said earlier. That was a mistake on my part to say that. All right, so we have the wicked again who's going to repent, and he's going to live. We finish the chapter, verses 29 on, says, but the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord isn't fair. See, they're blaming again. That's what's happening. That's what we're seeing in the, I think, in a lot of the elections. It's not right what's happening. We're seeing everybody blaming one another. But God says, are my ways not right, O house of Israel? Is not your ways, is it not your ways that are not right? We got to stop looking at everybody else through what we think is right and look at them and situations through what God says is right. Then he says in verse 30, therefore, the conclusion to all of this, folks, is I'm going to do what? Judge you. You will be judged individually, and in this case, you're going to be judged corporately as a nation. I will judge you, O house of Israel, each according to his conduct, declares the Lord. So, therefore, he's telling them to do what? Repent and turn away from all your transgressions so that iniquity may not become a stumbling block for you. What does repent mean? Okay, it means you're really sorry. It means you go in the opposite direction. It means you do what it says, turn away. Repentance is not, oh, I'm sorry I got caught. Repentance is a genuine, heartfelt concern that you have sinned against God. And then when you repent, you go in a new direction. That's what God is telling them they need to do in order for him to relent. Verse 31. Cast away from you all your transgressions which you have committed and make yourselves a what? New heart and a new spirit. For why will you die, O house of Israel? God wants them to repent. God wants us to repent. God wants our country to repent, our nation, our world to repent. He doesn't want us to die. That's why he says, make yourself a new heart and a new spirit. It's not going to come because you wake up tomorrow and say, well, I'm going to do better. I'm going to be a better Christian American. It's only going to happen when we have a new heart and commit our lives to following God. And a new spirit within him. Because God says very clearly, I take no pleasure in the death of one who dies, says the Lord. Therefore, turn and live. Or therefore, repent and live. God doesn't want to bring judgment. God doesn't want to bring death, physical. God doesn't make the choice to bring spiritual death. We do. God doesn't want any of that. It's his will that not anyone should perish, but all should come to the knowledge of repentance. It's his will that everybody spends eternity with him. There's no zoning in heaven. There isn't just room for a million people. You know, it's as big as it can be. Everybody can go there, and that's God's will. It's not his will that we die. It's not his will that we turn away from him. That's our personal choice. So today, two questions. The personal choice about how you're walking with Jesus. Are you walking in righteousness as the first and third generation did? Or are you walking in wickedness as the second generation did? How you live shows where your heart is. And then we have to ask ourselves the major question, and that is, have I turned my heart and my spirit over to Jesus Christ so that I can live eternally with him? That's the most important question you're ever going to get. And that's one that you've got to make sure you've got the answer to. Because if you don't, you may die. Not just the first death, but the second. You will die. Not just the first death, but the second death. Let's pray. Oh, Father, it's so easy to blame other people for our issues. Because after all, we don't make mistakes. It's got to be somebody else's fault. And yet, Father, you were so frustrated in what we just read when Israel tried to blame you and say it wasn't right. Who are we to question you? Our ways are not your ways. Or should I say, your ways are not our ways. You see totally differently than we do. We need to turn ourselves to you so we see your ways and we do your righteousness and we live according to your principles. Father, I pray tonight that you will speak to each one of us and let us realize we've got to stop blaming our country, our spouses, our families, our bosses, or whatever. We've got to stop blaming and take personal responsibility for our lives, whether it be a bad marriage, whether it be financial difficulties, whatever our issues are, we've got to stop blaming somebody else and stop and say, okay, God, I'm responsible for this. One way or another, sure, somebody else may be involved, but I have to take personal responsibility for this situation. And I have to take personal responsibility for my life with you. When I have the opportunity to stand before you, I want it to be in heaven, and I want to stand in righteousness, taking full individual responsibility for what I do and not trying to blame anybody else. I pray tonight that you will speak to our hearts and show us if we have a relationship with you, permanent, eternal relationship with you. And if we don't, or if we're not sure, oh, Father, talk to me, talk to somebody in this room so that we can pray with you to make sure that you will spend eternity with Jesus Christ. That's the most important decision you will ever make. We pray you'll make it tonight if you haven't already. And if you have made that decision, then how are you living? Is it honoring God? We're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that if we take communion in the wrong heart, God could strike us dead right then. If we're living in the wrong heart right now, we could die. You might not allow us to live, God. So I pray that we will turn to you in confession and repentance today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today on Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank. Living Word Ministries is a listener-supported program. To contact Debbie Blank, you may do so at livingwordministry.org. That's www.livingwordministry.org. Please tune in each week at the same time for Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank.